morning. Sara Nada with you to give you the course Game Theory. Okay, today's lecture is lecture 15, which should have been taking place at the faculty on Tuesday, March 20. In today's lecture, we are going to apply what we have explained last lecture on economics, so an economic application on the dynamic games. We will have a dynamic model of duopoly, which is called a Stackelberg model of duopoly. So today we are going to explain the Stackelberg model of duopoly. First of all, as you noticed, we call it a dynamic model of duopoly, which means that the game that is to be played by firms in this model is a dynamic game. So it's a sequential game, not a simultaneous game, as the previous economic applications that we have studied in the course. In the Stackelberg model of duopoly, firms choose quantities, so they choose the quantity to produce. We will study the simple model of duopoly. Duopoly means that there are two firms, a dominant firm and a follower firm. The dominant firm will move first, but the follower firm will move second. So the dominant firm will choose the quantity to produce first, then the follower will observe the quantity produced by firm 1 and choose its quantity in the second stage of the game. We will assume that the dominant firm is firm 1, so I will call the firm which will move first firm 1, which is the dominant firm. And the firm that will move at the second stage will be firm 2. So 1 is the firm that will take the first step, and 2 for the firm that will take the second step. What is the timing of the game? We will have, as we said, that firm 1 chooses quantity Q1 that is greater than 0, a positive quantity. Then, at the second stage, firm 2, which will move second, firm 2 will observe the quantity produced by the first firm and chooses its quantity that has to be greater than or equal to 0. The payoffs for this game is the profits. The payoff is the profit of each firm. So the payoffs are the profits of both firms. We have the profit is represented by the function pi I, which is function of Q1 and Q2. Pi I, where I refers to the firm, I can be 1 or 2. We can write this explicitly. So we can write that I equals to I So I equals to 1 and 2. Okay. This means that we have for each firm its own profit, and the profit function for each firm were represented by QI times capital P of Q minus C. What are those letters? First of all, we have I equals to 1 and 2 referring to the firm that we are considering. Pi refers to the payoff or the profit. And QI, small QI, refers to the quantity to be produced by firm I. The capital P is the price to be set by each firm. And capital Q, as you can see from the slide, that capital Q is the total quantity of the market. So capital Q equals to Q1, small Q1 plus small Q2. And finally, we can define the C to be the costs that each firm will face or will have to pay in order to produce this quantity. Again, we are explaining in today's lecture the Stackelberg model of duopoly, which is an application to the dynamic models that we have studied last lecture. In Stackelberg model of duopoly, we have two firms. The first firm chooses its quantity first, firm one, then firm two observes the quantity set by firm one, and at the second stage, firm two will choose which quantity to produce. Payoffs are given by the function pi I, as we have explained in this slide. So let's move on. How to solve this model? As we explained last lecture, that dynamic models can be solved using backward induction. So we are going to solve this, the model, our application, our economic application, by the backward induction. How can we do that? Because we don't have a tree. We have two firms. Each firm has to set a quantity. So as you can notice that the actions are infinite. In order to solve using the backward induction, as we did in previous economic applications related to oligopoly markets, we are going to compute each firm's best response function. But remember that when we solve using backward induction, as we explained thoroughly in our last lecture, we start by the end of the game, which means that in this game, according to the timing that we have mentioned in the first slide, in the previous slide, we will start by firm 2 because we start by the end of the game. So the last action is to be chosen by firm 2. So firm 2 is going to maximize its profit. Okay, so firm 2 will maximize its profits, as you can see that it will choose the quantity Q2 that is greater than or equal to 0, such that this quantity maximizes its payoff. What is the payoff of firm 2? This is, okay, why it's not writing? This is the payoff of firm 2. What is this? This is exactly, if you go back to the previous slide, you can see that the payoff is the quantity. So in this case, it will be Q2. Times P of Q minus C, which is exactly A minus Q1 minus Q2 minus C. Remember that we have defined the price function or the demand function in our previous economic applications. So this is just substituting everything in the profit function. Again, firm 2 is going to maximize its payoff, which is this one that I underlined, and choose the quantity Q2. How can firm 2 maximize this? As you already know, and you did several times in this course and in other courses as well, that we have to get the first derivative and equate this first derivative to 0. Doing this, this will give us the best response function. So we have, we will get, if you get the first derivative with respect to Q2 and equate this first order condition to 0, we will get that Q2 equals to A minus C minus Q1, all this divided by 2. What is this? This is not the optimal quantity, as you know. This is the best response function. So solving for the optimal quantity for firm 2 gives the best response function of firm 2. We will assume that Q1 is less than A minus C because we need Q2 to be positive, which you can easily see from the equation. If you remember Cournot model, you can notice that this best response is exactly the same as in Cournot because we are still up to this stage, we are still doing the same. Okay, again, so we got the best response of the second firm, the firm that is going to move second. We will notice that this best response that I am circling here, this is the same as in Cournot. Now let's move. We know what is the best response for firm 2. What we should do next? We should do the same for firm 1, the firm that is going to move first. But remember that in dynamic games, we rely on an important assumption, which is the assumption of complete and perfect information, which means that firm 1 knows about the best response of firm 2 that we have just calculated in the previous slide. This means that firm 1 will anticipate that each quantity it will choose, each Q1 chosen by firm 1, will be met by the best response Q2. Because firm 1 knows about the best response of firm 2, it will take this into account, which is exactly what we were doing when we were solving using the backward induction. Remember the tree, the different example that was a lateral tree? It is exactly the same concept, because we will have firm 1 knows about the best response of firm 2. So when firm 1 is going to choose its quantity, it will take this into account. How will this happen? As we know, firm 1 choosing the quantity to produce, it takes into account its payoff. So what will firm 1 do is that it will maximize its payoff and choose the quantity Q1 that will maximize this payoff. Excuse me. Okay. Then, so firm 1 is going to maximize its payoff and it will choose the quantity Q1 that will maximize this payoff. But this time, the payoff of firm 1, pi 1, as you can see from the slide, that pi 1 is function of Q1 and the best response. Instead of substituting Q2, firm 1 knows about the best response, so it knows what is the best response for each Q1. So it will substitute this in its profit function and it will maximize this function that takes into consideration the best response of firm 2 with respect to Q1. So this means that we have the profit function. Instead of substituting Q2, we are going to substitute what we calculated in the previous slide, the quantity, the best response quantity that is equivalent to Q2, which was A minus C minus Q1, all this divided by 2. Solving this maximization problem, you will easily see that, so after doing this substitution, you will have the payoff of firm 1 is this one here. It will be Q1 times this bracket A minus Q1 minus C over 2. You can do the calculations. It is very simple, just a simple algebra, and you can arrive to this payoff, this form of the payoff after simplification. Now it is easy. If you really understand the concept, it is easy because we can proceed as we were doing. We maximize this payoff function with respect to Q1, which means that we need to get the first order conditions, we need to get the first derivative with respect to Q1 and equate this first derivative to zero and solve for Q1. Doing this will give you the equilibrium quantities or the optimal quantities for both firms, Q1 star A minus C over 2 and the Q2 star, which is equal to A minus C over 4. When we are going to solve for Q1, then we will get Q1 star. After getting Q1 star, remember that we have the best response of firm 2, which was Q2 function of Q1. So to get Q2 star, we need to substitute the optimal value of Q1 in the best response of firm 2 in order to get Q2 star. Doing all these easy steps, we can get, as is seen and written in front of you in the slide, Q1 star equals to A minus C over 2 and Q2 star equals to A minus C over 4. Okay, summarizing what we were doing until now. We were explaining the Stackelberg model. We have only two firms. We are moving in a dynamic game. So firm 1 will move first, then firm 2 will observe the quantity that is chosen by firm 1 and choose its quantity. How to solve such a model? We solve dynamic models. We rely on backward induction to solve for the dynamic models. Using backward induction, we will start from the end of the game. So we start by firm 2. We will calculate the best response of firm 2. Then we will go one step back. So we will go back to the first step, which is firm 1. Firm 1 is going to do the same, maximize its payoff. But this time, firm 1 knows about the best response of firm 2. So firm 1, when maximizing its profits, it will take this into account because it is conditional upon the quantity that firm 2 is going to choose. So we will insert the best response here in the payoff, this one, and calculate the quantity that will maximize its payoff. Doing this, we will get the Q1 star A minus C over 2, and substituting this back into the best response function of firm 2, we will get the Q2 star, which is equal to A minus C over 4. Remember that we have studied in the course an economic application in which the firms are choosing or setting their quantities. Yes, exactly. This reminds you of the Cournot model of oligopoly. If you remember also, we in the Cournot model, the quantities of both firms was A minus C over 3. So in Cournot, we have the optimal quantities A minus C over 3. So this is for Cournot. Okay, this means that in Stackelberg model, the firm that will move first is going to produce bigger quantity than what it would have produced in Cournot model, while the follower firm is going to produce a lower quantity than it would have produced in the Cournot firm. Okay, so simply, what in order to compare between Stackelberg and Cournot. In the next slide, we are going to compare using different criteria, but one simple criteria is to compare the solution of both models. In Cournot, the quantity produced is A minus C over 3, while in Stackelberg, the leader firm, the dominant firm, will produce the quantity equals to A minus C over 2, while the follower will produce a quantity A minus C over 4. It is clear that the dominant firm in Stackelberg model will produce a quantity that is larger or greater than the quantity that it would have produced in Cournot, while the follower will produce a lower quantity than it would have produced in Cournot. Let's move to the next slide. Okay. So, how to compare other criteria between Stackelberg and Cournot? The first, looking at the aggregate quantity that is to be produced in both markets. Remember, what is the aggregate quantity? We defined the aggregate quantity in our first slide and in the previous economic applications of oligopoly to be capital Q. What is capital Q? It is the summation of the quantity that is to be produced by both firms. If we sum both quantities in Stackelberg model, we will find that the aggregate quantity equals to 3 over 4 times A minus C. While in Cournot, the aggregate quantity is 2 over 3 A minus C. This means that the aggregate quantity that is to be produced in the Stackelberg model will be greater than the aggregate quantity to be produced in Cournot. So, not only that there are differences between the quantities to be produced by each firm, but the aggregate quantity in a Stackelberg model is greater. This implies something about the price. For example, using the law of demand, you can easily know that because the quantity is greater, then we are expecting the market clearing price of Stackelberg to be lower. What about the profits in both models? Well, the profits for firm 1 in Stackelberg is going to be greater, but the aggregate profits will decrease. Why? Because we have just said that a greater quantity means or implies the price will be lower. If the price will be lower, then the profits of the second firm will be lower in the Stackelberg. So we will have the profits of the first firm or the dominant firm will be greater, while the profits, the aggregate profits will decrease because the profits of the follower firm will be lower in the Stackelberg model. So, if we want to make a comparison between Stackelberg and Cournot, we have just stated that, but we can summarize what we have said in few points. First, the quantity that is produced by the dominant firm is greater in the Stackelberg, and it is the quantity produced by the follower is lower. Comparing the aggregate quantity between both models, we can find that the aggregate quantity produced in the Stackelberg model is greater than the aggregate quantity produced in Cournot. For the price, this first difference implies that the price will be lower in the Stackelberg model of oligopoly, and the profits, aggregate profits will be lower in Stackelberg, but the aggregate profits of the dominant firm will be greater, and the aggregate profits for the follower firm will be lower. I think this is enough for today's lecture. There is a lot of math, I actually ask you to calculate, to do the calculations that we have mentioned throughout the slides. You need to check them because if we were in class, I would have asked you to do these calculations. But now you are at home, you can sit down and relax and do the calculations quietly. That's it for today's lecture, yes. I think that it is quite clear. I'm sure if we were in class, you would have asked me to repeat everything, but now instead of repeating everything, you can do the repetition yourself at home. If you have any questions, please write to me and I will take all of them into consideration. Thank you and see you next lecture.